Welcome to JC Near and How We Got Here, the show where you get an inside look into the stories and experiences that brought each of our staff here to the reserve. So I'd like to extend a special thank you to our guest today, Thomas Gertuz. So Tom is our research coordinator here at the reserve, and he has been with us for about a year and a half under that title, but as we'll come to learn, it's more interconnected than just that year and a half. So let's take a little bit of a rewind. So very beginning, what made you realize you wanted to have a career in the sciences and even have a career in research?
Well, I figured I wanted a career in the sciences once I found out what science was, or that's when I identified it. I was already interested in it long before I knew what it was. I grew up without a TV. We didn't have one in the family. What we had was National Geographic. And and back in the early 60s, when I was born, that's when the Conshelf series was coming out. This is a whole series of articles about Jacques Cousteau's attempts to establish prototype habitats on the ocean floor, mostly in the Mediterranean. And so what they called the aquanauts would go down and live in these for extended periods of time. So there was deep houses where they were under saturation conditions, and then shallower places like the starfish house. But they lived there for a long time, weeks to months, and people would bring them food, and they would use that to do operations underwater, exploration type things, but it was proof of concept. So I was really, really intrigued by that, by the pictures and the stories in that. We would go to the neighborhood parks, and I was always fascinated by knowing that something was happening under that flat lake surface. So there's people fishing around the end, and they'd put out a line and it would pull and they'd get something. And you'd look in their bucket, and this is when I'm a toddler, right? I always wanted to see what was coming up next, why one thing was pulled up one time or a different thing, like what's happening under that water that you can't see. And I'd always reach into these buckets and pull out the fish till the fisherman would tell me to stop. I was that kid. So very early on then already, I was scrounging like lost hooks and lines around the park, you know, from the trees and stuff, from snags,
yeah,
from people casting and making cheese baits or whatever to catch fish. My mom tolerated that. I was also catching lizards and snakes. We lived in the neighborhood on the edge of kind of sage area, chaparral, and I could do that. But it was always fish that I liked the most.
Mm-hmm.
And in California, I had close access to the beach. I was always surfing and diving, snorkeling really early on. And I knew I wanted to do that. The thing was, what kind of job is in that?
Yeah.
So once I had high school, or even, you know, grade school biology, and then later on high school biology as a science, which started out with parasites. I still remember our opening lecture there. I was fascinated and saw the connection between where I wanted to work and the kinds of questions I was interested in, and that became, you know, marine biology as I understood it, and it remains that way. So yeah.
So you said you grew up. So you grew up in California.
Yeah, that's
now,
correct. Born in Santa Monica Beach.
So what are the differences between the beaches? I personally never been out there. So what are differences between the beaches and the coastline where you grew up versus here in southern New Jersey?
Right, they're very different. California is an active margin, so that piece of land, the continent, is pushing over the top of an oceanic crust, which is subsiding underneath it. That's why we have so many earthquakes. But that also makes a trench where that fold happens, where the subduction happens. So California, that means two things. One is that the California margin is very rocky. So there are some sandy beaches, but basically you've got lots of rock,
okay,
cliffs and coves, rocky coves, and the shoreline gets deep very quick. We don't have a continental shelf like we do have here. We have in California what's called an escarpment. It just tumbles off and gets
dropped
deep,
real quickly.
Yeah, deep quickly. And you notice that even close to shore, there's a surf line, but below that, you could be diving in 80 to 100 feet of water very quickly, from like a quick swim from the beach. So the landscape's very different for that reason, and the seascape is very different. There's rock reef, a lot of rock reef instead of mud and sediment, and that has kelp beds on it, which are really, really lush forests, very high nutrient regime. It can be very clear, but also very murky, both. You get big swells coming in from the Pacific. But besides that, there's also some real big differences in the ocean climate. So California doesn't vary in the temperature as much as the Atlantic coast does, the mid-Atlantic coast. I'll talk about that a little bit when I come to the Atlantic coast. But it's a little bit more stable in the temperature because of where the water is coming from. And also the Pacific Ocean is very old, much older than the Atlantic. And in fact, the Atlantic Ocean fish population was inoculated from the Pacific Ocean. So you see much, much higher diversity in the Pacific Ocean as far as fishes go. For instance, there's about 58 species of rockfishes spread out between, that's just one genus, one genus of fish spread out from about, you know, Baja California all the way up through Alaska. Rockfishes are very diverse. There's lots and lots of dozens of different flatfishes along that stretch. And what you see in the Atlantic is very closely related, but much fewer of them, because the Atlantic used to be open to the Pacific during its formation, when it was just a crack and the Panama Isthmus wasn't closed and fish, when it was warmer, could get up around the top of Alaska and what is now Canada and move into the Atlantic and inoculate it. So things like Atlantic cod, you look at them, they look just like Pacific cod, but there's fewer different species of cod in the Atlantic than the Pacific. The Pacific's fairly diverse in those. Pollock look the same. Walleye pollock on the Pacific side, Atlantic pollock on the Atlantic side. Halibut, Pacific halibut, Atlantic halibut, enormous animals in the 300 pound range, look very, very similar. Down on the more tropical edge of that basin, or the two basins, you see, for instance, Goliath groupers, which are tremendously big groupers. The same species, now recognized as subspecies, occur on both sides of the Panama Isthmus. So you get Goliath grouper on the Gulf of California side and on the Atlantic side throughout the Caribbean. So and it's just less diverse. Caribbean is diverse, but not as diverse as the tropical Pacific. So for a fish biologist, it was really, really interesting growing up there and getting myself inoculated in kind of the fishy world. It's very visually striking and exciting to go through those kelp beds. But when I moved to the East Coast, which is very different, the challenges and the issues must be the same because there's fundamentals that rule these things, but they look very different at first. And so it was intriguing to me to figure out how the game of life is played on this side at kind of the same latitude, which is very different. So the Atlantic is a trailing margin. The the continental plate is moving towards the west and kind of dragging the plate behind it. So what we have here is very, very old mountains, the Appalachian Mountains. Mm-hmm. They were formed basically as the weld when a subcontinent crashed into the main continental plate there, subcontinent called Avalonia, and raised those mountains. But they've since been worn way down. And as they were worn down to very low set of mountains now, the sediment from that naturally went down the slope and out to sea on this trailing continental margin and produced a thick wedge of sediments basically along the mid-Atlantic states. It changes to something different down in Florida, which is reef, but on, in this part, that sediment, and it was trapped on the edge and kept from falling off completely by some old reef prehistoric reef there. But essentially we have a very soft bottom here. Mm-hmm. And the other difference is that the climate's very, very different. It's not nearly as stable in terms of the annual temperature range. In fact, this region has the highest annual temperature cycle of any piece of ocean in the world. So we go from, off of New Jersey, we can go from below freezing, where the salt in the water keeps it from freezing, but it goes certainly below 0 Celsius. We've seen temperatures here down to like negative 1.2. And it goes up to almost tropical temperatures. So the ocean water can be 35 degrees C. And inside the creeks and stuff like that, the shallow estuaries, it can actually be much warmer, like into 40. Really, really warm temperature. So the animals here, they aren't reef animals so much, predominantly. And they have to migrate to deal with
those temperature changes.
With the temperature changes. And the whole seasonality is much more pronounced here. So instead of parochial reef fishes, you have a lot of migrants or things that have learned to cope with these extreme ranges by doing weird things like burying themselves for a good part of the winter in the marshes. So we also have much more marsh because it's flat here and because the range, you know, drains a lot of water. So you have these big, tremendous estuaries on this coast, which are not so prevalent on the west coast.
Oh, see, I didn't know that.
Right, big ones, the Hudson River, draining, you know, a region way up into Canada, or the Great Lakes, Laurentian Great Lakes, in the area around there, the Finger Lakes. You have the Delaware, which is draining parts of the Appalachian Shield, and that's big. That's a drowned river valley, so remember that sea level was a good 300 feet lower than what it is today during the last ice age, and that ice melt is part of what caused this, you know, that multiple times caused this wearing and drainage of the Appalachians, and scooped out these areas with river channels that actually cut across that shelf that's now submerged. So you have these canyons going across the shelf that were formed when that was dry because there were raging torrential rivers then. Mm. And as the sea level comes up, it floods into those and covers them, and they become these wide estuaries such as the Delaware Bay. And then you have the Chesapeake, which has the same issue of drainage, but also a meteor strike, call it a meteorite strike, created a crater there. And so the rivers are, it gives that kind of crinkled appearance because the rivers, there's multiple rivers to drain into that crater basin before they empty out into the ocean. And the Hudson was a glacial fjord. So it has a different physiognomy altogether. It has a very U-shaped, deep profile through rock that was scraped out by a glacier and left rock there, like Manhattan. So those things fascinate me now. They're different than what I grew up with, but again, fish, you know, and things that live in it still have the kind of common rules. They have common ancestry, as we talked about in the beginning, but they also have common rules of physiology and genetic adaptations and abilities that come from the same fishes that you see in the Pacific ancestrally, and are bound to some of those same rules but have different playing conditions.
Were you able to do any research or spend any time researching back in California before you started doing work here? Or even along the way too?
So we have been back, not to California, other than contributing to the development of proposals and work that's more global in scope. But in the field, we've been back to Alaska which is similar in many respects to California at different climate times, and even now, because of the stability that I talked about earlier, you know, the Kuroshio current that comes from Japan and spits to the north is the Pacific twin to the Gulf Stream on this side. So where the Gulf Stream gets warmed in the equatorial regions through the loop current and then flows along our coast and spits out to England and keeps it warm, given its high latitude and rainy. The Kuroshio current's doing the same thing to Alaska. So it puts warm water that was warmed in the tropics. It's cooling, of course, as it goes north, but it still has a lot of thermal capacity by the time it hits southeast Alaska. So you get that same rainy kind of damp there. But then it comes down as the Davidson current along the coast, and it's a big current, so there's a lot of thermal stability as it flows down towards California and eventually departs central California and swings out a little bit. It looks California-ish in many underwater respects. It still has reef and very, very, very steep drop-offs to deep water, big swells, lots of kelp beds, diverse fishes, until you get up around the corner of the Aleutians up into the Bering Sea. Then it changes to a slope, but southeast is a lot like California in many respects.
Okay. Now, so you talked a little bit about elementary school and like how you were able to experience really what science is about in terms of elementary and your in high school as well. Now, from there, what college did you, like, what was your schooling post high school?
Well, first I did community colleges, mostly because of my friends. I knew already that I wanted to do marine science, but I wasn't very aware of where that was going to happen. And certainly even at Fullerton College, where I went first, they had a strong marine program. We're at the beach. We're very close to it already, right? So there's the people there that know that kind of stuff. And I had a fantastic professor, and it was just amazing to go. And I actually traveled quite a bit with him. His name was Howard Craig, and he was a huge influence in my life and career from early on. So with several other students that were in his marine biology classes that were clearly gonna stick with the program, we went traveling with him, for instance, to Hawaii as a part of our scholastic career then. And we would just go hiking through Hawaii, along the cliffs in the ocean. We went diving when we were there. And the whole time we were talking. He was Socratian in his teaching. Anything you wanted to know, he'd come back as a question to you all the time. And it was fascinating. And that's where I actually got into the field, the specialty that I really enjoy now, which is broadly defined as the abundance and distribution of fishes, but more narrowly, an interest in recruitment of young fishes. And that's in Hawaii, which is a very diverse tropical place. It's still missing a number of species that you would see throughout the Pacific and the Caribbean, for instance. There's really basically two native groupers. There's other introduced grouper, but why not like the Caribbean? And then there's so many butterfly fishes. And you think, well, okay, so you're out in the middle of the ocean. He says, think about things, how they got here. And I'd say, well, this grouper, which can grow 6-7 feet long, certainly ought to have had a better chance of crossing to Hawaii across the ocean than something like a butterfly fish, which is very, very clearly tied to a coral reef environment. It has this long forceps like snout for, reaching into crevices and coral polyps and stuff that you find on a reef. how was it that that made it here and established and colonized the Hawaiian Islands? And he said, well, you're thinking of, you know, their forms as you see them. Who's to say that either of those swam? Like, chances are neither of them did, but you know, they came across as larvae. So fish larvae are very, very different from their adult forms. In fact, I would say they're as different ecologically as a caterpillar is from a butterfly, even though those are the same animal. They look and function very, very different. That larval stage of the butterfly is crawling around on plants and eating, mm-hmm. you know, eating leaves, and it's very much stuck on the ground and slow, while the butterfly moves around dines on nectar from flowers. So that difference isn't as apparent in fishes. And when you look at them, I mean, they don't change that. Well, they do even change drastically, not that drastically, but you have these clear planktonic animals. They don't have fins. They're essentially plankton. They can't swim against the viscous water at that size. And they get passed around by currents. And they're eating other smaller plankton for weeks to months before they change and they get pigment and they settle down and get their fins and change their shape and get spines and color and pigments that make them blend in and become reef animals. So a really different ecology. And that opposite of the butterfly, that's where they move. So as larvae, they can move tremendous distances in these currents and colonize, you know, far-flung new potential places like the Hawaiian Islands, which are young. They're just coming out of the ocean. You know, the older ones are subsiding into the oceans, but there's still Hawaiian Islands that are still forming and coming out of the ocean. And before they come out of the ocean, they're shallow. And before that, they're very deep volcanoes. There's no reef or anything there. So when they start coming out of the ocean surface is when you actually are at the stage where a reef can form and can start attracting reef fishes. But again, those aren't fishes that are swimming over. Mm-hmm. Those are fishes that are coming over as plankton. So that dynamic was really interesting to me. And that's where you end up having some of the bridge between that kind of reef and parochial fish and the dynamics that you get here on the East Coast, where many of the fish that are here, that we find here on our beaches, are actually coming from places like Florida and even the Caribbean as larvae. They're settling here. For instance, here in New Jersey, we get butterfly fish, coronet fish, trumpet fish. We get groupers, you know, tropical things, mullet, and they grow up very fast because we have this incredibly warm summer with a long photo period. Lots of production, and then they grow very fast and they either move out and migrate out, and which could be facilitated by their really fast growth here, or they die. And we see examples of both. The butterfly fish, they're never going to be migratory. They're, like I said,
they wouldn't be able to make it,
right? They can't make it. So they have to be the equivalent of a reef here. So you'll find them settling around the jetties, for instance, out in the ocean, or rock groins here in the estuary, or even mussel shells and stuff like that, or oyster beds, but they don't last because they can't leave that environment. And when it gets cold, they're dead. As opposed to things like mullet and bluefish, which can hightail it out of here.
So around when, during the annual climate cycle, does it get typically too cold for a species like the butterfly fish to really last?
That's an interesting question, and it might be changing actually, but the water temperature lags quite a bit behind air temperature. So you'll notice, like, you know, our warmest water temperatures in the estuary could be around July, mm-hmm. or excuse me, August. our warmest air temperatures, July or August, but the water can actually be a little bit warmer in August, September, and it's still pretty warm in October before it starts to rapidly crash. And so those water temperatures become really lethal in early November, but you can see some of those fish that are growing up from June, July, August settlement, mm-hmm. actually recruiting to traps because they're juveniles now. They're no longer larvae, and you'll see them into early November, and then they're going to start dying. And that work, some of that work was actually done here in this estuary by Dr. Ken Abel and his graduate students, mm-hmm. like Rich McBride, both looking at the distribution of tropicals over time from traps and different sampling programs in the estuary, and then also caging those fish or keeping them in the environment where they were caught, but just leaving there and checking on them, you know, kind of daily and seeing, oh, they're dying, which they would have anyways, but now you're keeping trapped by having them in a cage underwater. Mm-hmm.
That's really, especially with being a community college, you had the opportunity to go over to Hawaii. Because I know a lot of times those smaller schools, they might not necessarily have the funding to be able to have programs like that. Now, at that community college, were you there for an associate program, bachelor program?
Well, I knew I was, you know, wanted to move on to a bachelor's program. They only had an AA, and really I was just figuring out where it is that I wanted to go, mm-hmm. and how to get into marine biology properly. And because of the mentorship that I had there, I pretty quickly figured out that that UC Santa Barbara was the place for me. That's in the University of California system. So that sits on a broad peninsula up in a place, a community called Isla Vista, just north of the city of Santa Barbara. And so it has water literally on three sides of the two campuses. And so there's always a swell coming from one side, mm-hmm. a little bit of protection from the other. So, and literally the dorms were built, you know, on the bluffs on top of the beach. So you could surf and dive, literally suit up in your room and walk down. And I did that from day one. I mean, the day I got there, I went diving. And I remember that because my friend got shocked by an electric ray, a torpedo ray. Oof. We were doing an evening dive. He wasn't hurt. I was laughing so hard I flooded my regulator and my hands got water. But yeah, that was a really good place. It certainly kept me interested. And we were in the water for our field classes, dragging nets and seines, like I try to do with students here, both in the near and at Rutgers. So I finished a bachelor's there in aquatic biology, which includes freshwater systems.
Okay.
So that's the difference between marine biology and aquatic biology. Certainly, where I had the choice, I was doing marine systems, marine fishes in particular. And I also did like a senior capstone project there working with tide pool fishes and foraging capability. And after that, I went to work for about 2 years for the University of Southern California. So here, that's what we would call USC West, differentiated from the University of Southern South Carolina. But the Trojans, yeah. Okay, so they had a research vessel fleet that they co-managed as part of a consortium with Cal State Long Beach and the Vantuna, another vessel, which was Occidental College, so the kind of a marine sciences consortium. And USC also had the Wrigley Lab, which was this fantastic field station out on Catalina Island. So straight out of my bachelor's, I worked as the resident marine science technician for the USC research vessel fleet. So I actually lived on one of the ships rent free. They like to have people around the docks all the time to prevent theft and stuff like that. And I lived on a ship or a boat, and I would go out as the resident technician doing all kinds of the contracted research work for both USC and other universities that used those vessels. So I did fibro coring and box coring and trawls and rock drags. I was a deep sea camera tech for the deep sea quarters, And it was deep sea. You know, like I said, you could get out to deep sea very, very quickly. In fact, you were out in deep water before you even got to Catalina Island. That's an island that comes back up out of very deep water. And plankton hulls, all kinds of magnetometers, seismic work we did, deep benthic profiling, just really all kinds of stuff out there. I worked with some of the early acoustic releases that would let you put gear down on the ocean floor deep down without a buoy, and then at a certain time you could go out there with essentially an underwater speaker and transmit a signal that would release a buoy, a pop-up buoy, and float the package back up to the surface for recovery for things like sediment samplers, you know, that would collect marine snow that was settling down. So I was always out to sea then. Twice weekly we would run out to Catalina Island, and I essentially, as the science tech, I was also the boat's second operator, as you will, you know, I'd stand wheel watch or be the deckhand. So we'd have a layover on Catalina Island and I could go diving. So we would take off with one of the skiffs and go around the corner out of the reserve and go spearfishing for a couple hours and come back and run back. This was a standard milk run, you know, that we did to deliver groceries to the lab and stuff like that. But I was out at sea a lot then, all the time. During that time, one of the jobs we did was a contracted worker for a professor at Cal State Northridge named Dr. Larry Allen, who was doing work on recruitment of white sea bass, which is not white and it's not a sea bass or a bass. It's a big member of the drumfish family, or the croakers. And that fish was one that I was particularly enamored with as a spear fisherman. It's like the trophy fish for that coast. And he was working on it, so I was talking to one of his graduate students, and he said, oh, Larry's taking graduate students now. So I took a couple of his summer courses on fish ecology and fish behavior, and got myself recruited as a master's student for him.
Okay.
And then back on the same boats that I had worked on previously, because he continued to use those boats for his work, but now I was the charter on the vessel rather than the deckhand or science tech. So again, we were back at all the islands now, the Channel Islands, Santa Cruz, Santa Rosa, Anacapa, Santa Barbara, Catalina, San Clemente, and ranging on trips all the way down the Baja Peninsula to Bahia Magdalena, sampling fish all along the way, fishing, spear fishing, to collect guts and gonads and blood samples for DNA and age and growth from the otoliths and size and weights. And we just fished and spear fished our way along, collected a tremendous amount of information in those days, really doing a survey of that fish diversity along the coast and looking at a distribution and abundance. Really, these are fishes that were settled on reefs throughout that range, but had different population sizes of different things at different places. One of the really neat things was that because California has basically mostly southward flow, one of the things that you could see is these recruitment patterns where, and this was worked by Bob Cowan, who at the time was at Scripps, and Scripps Institute of Oceanography as a graduate student, and Dan Bodkin, on the recruitment patterns of fish, especially to the south, where the islands, which are not very well connected to the mainland, were either self-recruiting their populations of fishes or receiving recruits from the north. And the northern islands only got fishes when the current reversed. And this happens during El Niños, because in El Niño, the water that's flowing westwards towards Asia basically bounces back as a big warm pool and splashes back against the equatorial region, and then as it splashes back, it forces its way back up along the California coast and part of it back down along the South American coast, and creates havoc, really changes things, because that is water that has been warmed in the tropics and was headed westward, but now it's kind of sloshed back eastward and splashed along those coasts. So the progeny, the eggs and larvae from the southern islands are now flowing northward. So what you get when you sample fishes in the southern islands are fishes of all year classes, so many year classes, whereas in the northern islands, when depending on when you sampled them, you might see a group of these large old fish and then no medium-sized fishes for a while, and then a group of very young fishes of that same species. And when you look at the age of those fishes, which you can do by pulling out their ear bones, you saw that they were all the same year, and the year they came from was these El Nino years.
Okay.
So I got really interested in that and did basically a genetic version of that aging study, looking at how these islands and mainland populations were connected, but by a forensic technique, the same as you do for looking at kind of, you know, paternity or criminal types of things, right? Something similar to that. And at that time, I was also interested in Bob Cowan's work. So in the meantime, Bob Cowan had become a professor at SUNY Stony Brook, State University of New York, in Long Island. So when I finished my work with Larry Allen in California and was looking for a graduate program, that seemed like a really good next step. I talked to him. Larry Allen introduced me to him at a big Texas barbecue at one of these ASIH meetings, American Society of Ichthyologists and Herpetologists meetings in Texas. That's what those meetings do, right? They're big networking meetings besides talking about your work. And that's where the value of those barbecues and social events are at. I still see the importance of them today. So when I have interns and graduate students, I try to get them to those meetings also, and try to, you know, they're a little bit nervous, like I was then, talking to these eminent people. But, you know, it's lubricated by food and beer and whatnot. So you get in there and you're happy to talk to them and find out that they're not so scary. And they're looking for graduate students. And you do it. You have the conversations and get involved. And so I went on to do my PhD that way with Bob Cowan at SUNY Stony Brook.
So was that when you made your first kind of initial move to this coast?
Yep, that's exactly how that happened. And again, working with movement of larvae. Mm-hmm. So this time I wasn't working just with the genetic inference of what had happened, but trying to catch them in the act. So I was out off Cape Hatteras, which is this big faunal transition zone. And I was catching those larvae in the different water masses that collide there, the Gulf Stream, the subtropical warm water masses from, you know, Charleston and south, and the cooler water coming down from the Gulf of Maine and entering this region down here and mixing, and looking at the mixing and segregation of those two different incoming larval streams and what it meant for recruitment here north of Cape Hatteras. Again, related to that issue of high temperature change, annual temperature change and stuff like that. So yeah, and he in turn introduced me, that's Bob Cowan, in turn introduced me to Ken Abel, whom he was working with on issues of recruitment of larval fishes to juveniles along the coast here. And Ken Abel was looking for a postdoc at the time, so I came here as a postdoc and transitioned into research faculty.
Now, how was that, having your first experience with this high temperature range that you experience here versus California? Was that something that was kind of a surprise to you?
No, I knew about it, of course, going in, because it had oceanography. I mean, it was revealed in the rich detail once I got here. But, you know, people know it can snow in New Jersey and in a different way than it does in California, right? You can be at the coast in California and have nice warm surfing temperature and you just drive to the snow by going uphill, right? But here in New Jersey, you don't have that mountain crashing right down into the sea as it does in California. So, you know, I knew the East Coast and, you know, up in New England was very seasonal and the seas were already, I knew them as seasonal. And I knew it wasn't a place of, you know, reefs except for largely artificial. There are some natural outcroppings and reefs, but largely the reefs that we have here are artificial to attract reef fishes and maybe increase their number. And that's still a kind of an ongoing debate. It's being settled, but the difference between whether you're concentrating reef fish or actually growing more reef fish by giving them habitat is one of those questions that square between the question of kind of recruitment and movement of larvae versus adults, right? Because if they're adults that are recruiting, you're concentrating things onto a reef, but if it's larval settlement that would otherwise be lost, then you're making more fish or allowing more reef fish to survive and their population to grow. So that remains, and the management of those species because of that question really remains a practical application of the kind of work I do. There's other practical applications, for instance, in the design of reserves or preserves, marine protected areas where fishing doesn't happen. They could really work in one place and might be completely the wrong thing in other places. For instance, if you don't have a reef that is a complete life cycle for a fish, that's maybe very highly migratory and not parochial, then protecting that reef space doesn't really do much. It's not necessarily, on the other hand, when it is a really critical part and you're exporting fish that are migrants at a later stage or that move, then it is important and that does work. It's not one size fits all. And you do see more of that model of management on the West Coast than you see on the East Coast, but it's being tried here and there's a place for it here too. But yeah, it's a practical application for the kinds of things that I study. Though I don't, you know, I'm interested whether it's practically applied or not.
Yeah.
It's a curiosity thing, so.
So how long did you wind up working with Ken?
Well, I still work with Ken. So I came here in 1999 I'd essentially finished my dissertation, but my graduation officially was at the end of that semester. But I came here in May of 99 and began working with Ken as a postdoc and then transitioned into research faculty as I started contributing to getting grant money for the work that we were doing together. And now Ken just retired last year as the director of the Rutgers University Marine Field Station. But I still work with him. We have, I'm not writing grants with him because he's no longer involved in grant writing because of his retirement, but he can still be involved in grants that I write. And our work is certainly connected. He's been a really great mentor to me, and the questions that he asks have led to the questions that I asked and continue to ask. And we are working on papers together that we started months to years ago that are coming to fruition. That's a long cycle in many events, between first getting funding and then doing the work and then writing it up and it going through review and revision and then finally publication. So yeah, there's still stuff in the pipeline with him for sure. And I hope that there still will be, because he still has a lot to contribute. Right. He just can do it on his
on his time.
Schedule now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, through your work, so you became a faculty member, then how did that transition over from working there to being under the title of J. Senior?
Right. There was the J. Senior was a presence here at Rutgers before I came here, actually. And also Mike DeLuca, who is the director, manager of the Jaxo Reserve, was also at the time the manager of the NERC Center. So NERC is the National Energy Research Program, and there is a local chapter entity, whatever, the Mid-Atlantic Research Center, or Mid-Atlantic NERC. Which so those entities themselves are NOAA, as is the J. Senior. Mm. So the whole reserve system is a NOAA entity. And at the time, NERP and NERC were also NOAA entities. The role of the NERP, which was kind of higher risk exploration work rather than really directed hypothesis driven work. This was more technology advancement and exploration. That role got subsumed into a new program under NOAA, which was under the Office of Ocean Exploration and Research, OER. So in its kind of dying days, as it was being subsumed, let's just back up a second. The NERC was giving out grants for that kind of money. It was a grant passed through a broker for NOAA to do that kind of work. And I applied for a grant and got a grant to use a NERC asset, which was the autonomous underwater vehicle and also passive acoustics, just listening to fish under that. That was kind of in its beginnings back then, listening to fish. So I applied for a grant. I was not with the NERC then, or with the J. Senior. But after I finished that work and showed my willingness to kind of get into this technology kind of risk area of tech, Mike said, well, you'd be good as the research director for the NERC. So basically to look at proposals like my own, but now from the other side, to look at and evaluate those for the NERC, which I did. And then secondly, as the NERC was being defunded and we didn't have grant money to give out anymore, Mike decided to use the vehicle itself as a grant. So NOAA partners could essentially ask for use of the vehicle, the robotic vehicle, the AUV, and the dive master, essentially director of underwater operations, Joe DeBarro and myself would go along on those missions and run those missions for the NOAA partners and demonstrate the utility of this vehicle, which was a NOAA asset, and try to get them, you know, moving past nets and things like that into this kind of more modern tech age. So I got to use the AUV under the direction of many different people that had different questions. So again, I was exposed to questions that had technology answers that weren't fish stuff, right? And they didn't necessarily have the tech answers. They had the questions and asked me to solve those kinds of tech questions. which I did together with Joe DeBarro. And that was a great deal of fun. And in that, and I do mean fun. I mean, to a biologist or a marine scientist, work is fun because you get something out of it, mm-hmm. right? You get satisfaction from meeting those challenges. So we would travel and do these things, and I saw the potential for the use of the AUV in my own work on fish recruitment and fish movement, especially because by this time I was getting into telemetry or tracking larger fish with implanted acoustic tags. And that works well kind of under this turnstile model where you set up hydrophones, kind of like turnstiles, in an estuary that has a constricted mouth, and you know when fish come and go because they have to pass those. But out in the open ocean, you can't do that very well. You have to go looking for them. And so the AUV or a ship is needed. And it turns out the AUV can do that better than a ship. So I got involved with that. And as NERC finally was completely defunded, the AUV transitioned over to its sister NOAA entity, which was the JCNIR, still under Mike's direction. And I began working with the JCNIR more and more frequently, perhaps through the connection of the AV, but also in general to talk to the teachers that were here under JCNIR programs and the managers that came in first, mostly on questions about AV application for the benefit of the NIRs, but also on the more traditional things about recruitment roles in estuaries, not just here, but talking with the other estuarine research reserves through this research reserve, collaborative proposals and stuff like that. So I was receiving funding through the NIRs, passed through for a while, and was involved with talks here and outreach applications and AUV applications through the JCNIR for a number of years, even going to the national meetings to present particular talks on that specialty there. So when the position opened here, I fit already and I transitioned into it. And that's fairly recently, like you said, just mm-hmm. since, not this October, but the previous 2018. So I've been here a year and a half about. But already quite familiar with what was going on in the years. And the JCNIR specifically.
Right. I'm sure that proved to be a nice smooth transition.
Yeah, I think it was.
Yeah.
Maybe a little bit too smooth because since I wasn't a newbie, I wasn't involved in so much of the initial orientation.
Okay.
So like I didn't know about the schedules of reporting. I found out about and continue to find out about some of those. Wait, I was supposed to do what?
Oh, yeah.
I was due when? Because it was kind of assumed that I already knew all that. Mm-hmm. Not necessarily by anybody else, but certainly by me.
Yeah.
Oh, I can skip the orientation. not quite like that, but you know, when it was a matter of finding priorities between orientation and writing a proposal or something, I was like, well, you know, I'm already involved in this proposal, I gotta go do that, and so I'll figure the rest out.
Yeah.
So yeah, it was smooth in many respects, but also I'm still finding where the hiccups were.
Yeah.
That I missed.
So what kind of projects are you working on at the moment?
So I continue to work on projects that come both through the NIRS and through collaborations that were formed at my Rutgers mm-hmm. faculty position that are not through the NIRS. Mm-hmm. And some of them go together. Currently, we have an AUV demonstration development project that is actually driven by the Marine Biological Laboratories at Woods Hole, Loretta Roberson, who I actually knew as a graduate student and shared an office space with her when I was a master's student under Larry Allen. But mm-hmm. she was in Puerto Rico and then at MBL and drove this program on seaweed farming for energy development mm-hmm. off of Puerto Rico. And right from the get-go, this project needs to return kind of that energy product, but also as a pilot project, they know, because this has happened in the past, that there's potential side effects, for instance, disruption of local ecology by placing this big kelp farm in the shallow waters off Puerto Rico. So what are the fish response and the environmental responses there? So in the AV, the Department of Energy really wanted robotics involved from the get-go, kind of to automate these things. So I was entrained as a collaborator on that project, and that's really just getting started now, as far as I'm concerned. Earlier phase looked at the piloting of the farm itself, and now we're getting into siting the farm and looking at environmental impacts through robotics. So from both the fish side and the AAV side, I'm involved with that. I am involved with several long-term series of fish recruitment experiments looking at both the movement of fish into the estuary as larvae and the recruitment of those fishes once they are in the estuary. And those are 30-year programs that were created by Ken Abel. And in his retirement, I'm taking kind of the lead on the day-to-day activities of those as well, and on the analysis of the patterns that we can now go to. And that actually began already, that collaboration with Ken before he retired, but that certainly continues now. So over that period of 30 years, we've seen kind of a shift at about 2000 in ocean climate that's different from, or could be different from, the long-term warming trend, but there's other cycles that run through ocean climate that are decadal type cycles. So now that we have a long enough term, sampling period to look at decadal cycles, we're doing that. We're looking at climate change as experienced by larvae that are incoming and juveniles that are recruiting and growing in the estuary. So that's a large part of my analytical and writing period right now, as well as writing proposals to advance that in the future. Some of my telemetry work continues with collaborators in Alaska, both on actually tracking fish, but also on advancing the ability of the AAV to do that. So we're working with collaborators and things like artificial intelligence to work on giving the AAV a backseat driver and making it even more autonomous in its decision-making to track fishes the way that a captain of a ship might make decisions when they're tracking things. And these have led to collaborations in the Philippines, where I tracked pelagic thresher sharks with Simon Oliver from the UK, and that was part of a Discovery Channel Shark Week show.
Okay.
But it continues in the Gulf of Mexico, where we've done work on hypoxia, looking at the response of fishes to the dead zone formation, or juvenile fishes. Again, very challenging. This is where that my interest in the distribution and ecology of fishes meets the AAV, because it's a way of solving some of those challenges. It can measure many things at the same time, including tracking the fishes. So yeah, those are the main things, is starting to get involved in microplastics. Very small recent grant to pilot looking at microplastic ingestion in the long-term time series of fishes. Still looking at working with partners on the east side of the Atlantic along Norway and UK at basking sharks, potentially genetics and microplastics ingestion there, because they are big planktivores. They just swim like a giant filter through the sea. Yeah, it remains really diverse. All kinds of stuff. It's all interesting to me. At this point, I kind of have to triage it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, through as all these projects are now starting to come to fruition, you're starting to kind of get into the meat and potatoes of it. Where do you have any goals for your work here in terms of not even just maybe research and research topics in and of itself, but even just like growth of the program or what you hope to kind of accomplish with your work?
Yeah, here? Yes, for sure. One of the things that the JC NEARS in particular, it's a near thing, and I think in particular a JC NEAR seems to do it really well, is outreach and taking the science to management for application and also to the public. Mm-hmm. So K through grade, right? Kindergarten through retirees. And we have fantastic involvement of retirees here through, they actually come in the field and help with the sampling, and they're crucial to that. And these are very involved people. They like to know the science beyond just being there in the field, and they transmit that to their peers, and that's exciting. And so the outreach thing in particular is something that I didn't do particularly well when I was just strictly a research professor, because it's not something that was particularly valued in that system early on. It is now more so because the funding agencies are pushing it. They are requesting integration of outreach into research, which usually what they cared about only was peer-reviewed publication. So that's certainly a sea change in the way that work gets funded, and therefore in the way it gets out. But the JC NEAR is perfect partner for that, because they have this great infrastructure for joining the really technical scientific aspect of work into outreach. And one of the things that really I noticed recently and want to rectify is the kind of erosion of public trust in science. Mm-hmm. And that comes from a number of sources. Part of it is that it's very easy to broadcast things that seem reasonable but totally aren't, through social media like Facebook. You can mm-hmm. just advance anything you want, say anything, and it seems true because it was written instead of, you know, you heard somebody say it. And some of those are strictly malicious. Some of them are really poorly informed. But in that distrust, it's apparent that there is, and this is our fault as a scientist, the disconnect in the understanding of how science gets done. Mm-hmm. Most people see science, the public sees the science after several filtering steps have happened, from the way that it gets done through a what we call primary research paper or peer-reviewed paper into a news article mm-hmm. that shortens it, or a blog or something like that, or even a Facebook post. So what's lost there is the techniques that we do in science, and the fact that we report uncertainty not as like, oh, we don't know, but actually as a measure of the bounds from in within which answers are calculated. It's not a problem, it's an asset to know. A good example is rain events. You have some certainty with which rain can be predicted. And one of the things that you see is that somebody might say, there's a 90% chance of rain. Well, a scientist might have said there's a chance of rain of 90%, which has this bound between 100% and 80%, right? And that's our uncertainty. Mm-hmm. So yes, we have uncertainty, and we publish that uncertainty as part of the answer, where somebody might just see 90%. Mm-hmm. Well, somebody can that doesn't understand science or that wants to misalign it can make hay with that. all they do, if they want to, is say, look, the scientists said they were uncertain. They're unsure. They don't know about, for instance, climate change. Mm-hmm. It's all speculation. It's not. But that's how it's being taken. So if somebody wants to politically have an agenda that that isn't suited to that, they'll say, oh, it's tremendous uncertainty. Look, if the weather forecaster says there's a 90% chance of rain, and he were to say, you know, explicitly, or she, that there's this 10 or 20% uncertainty with it, you're still going to bring your umbrella.
Yeah.
You know, there's a good chance it's going to rain. But that kind of language is, like I said, an opponent in some particular arena can make hay with that. So I really would very much like to work on not just communicating science to the public, but the way that science is done, how we measure uncertainty, what it means when we talk about uncertainty as part of an answer that we have, the fact that we can be certain about our uncertainty bounds, and what that means going forward, like the way that science progresses as a little brick at a time to make something more solid, what the difference between a theory and a hypothesis and a scientific law is. This stuff gets taught in high school, but I think it's very easy to forget about it or be dismissive of it when you're a scientist, or excuse me, when you're not a scientist. But it remains a foundation, and it's very, very similar to a court case. You have to present evidence. It's essentially innocent until proven guilty. We don't come up with something and try to bolster it. Mm-hmm. Rather, we try to disprove the basic that there's nothing going on, and chip away at that until we finally have to relinquish the fact that there's nothing going on, whether that's in a particular pattern of fish recruitment away from randomness or whatever it is. That's the way we do it. And we have to, just like any court case where you might have this reasonable doubt, we have a model similar to that in science. And it's really pretty tough. It goes through numerous steps all the way from beginning, when you have the inception of a question and you ask for money to do it. It's already being, your technique is already being evaluated at that point. Will this be able, the way that you propose to do it, be able to actually address the question, or are there holes in it that we can see right from the get-go that is going to leave tremendous uncertainty or other paths that could have accounted for this? So that's before you even get the money, and you have to have a pretty airtight case that explains the risks and uncertainty of being able to accomplish that goal right in the proposal before you get the money. And then you proceed to do the experiment, and you have to be really diligent in the completion of that experimental design, the statistics that go behind it, then the publication of it, and the way you present that, separate from and clearly delineating it from speculation, which has its place in the publication but has to be set aside from the evidence part as where to go to next. So that it really needs to be recommunicated or strengthened so that the public regains trust in the way that science is done and what it can do, and also what it can't do for them.
I think, and I completely agree, that it's something that I'm actually more and more, as I'm learning in my position, how things such as social media and just the internet as a whole can taint things and rework it to suit their particular angle. And it's everybody, the public in general, wants something that's certain. They want something that's ironclad, 100%. Yep. And that's not the way the world works. It's not the way nature works, not the way science works, and it makes people very uncomfortable. But people take advantage of that, and people don't want to embrace it. They see that uncertainty, and it's scary. But I think if it's communicated in a better way, or in a way that not necessarily a better way, but in a way that is more digestible.
Well, let's start with a way, period.
Yeah.
Because we didn't used to do it so much. So, like I said, in the early models, you just weren't rewarded for that, and you're uber busy, really. And so you do the stuff that the university or the present protocol wants from you. Now, it's interesting, the idea of uncertainty. There is a visceral connection with people in business, and especially in Wall Street. So the fact that we use the word stocks for fish stock, as pointed out by Carl Safina, a MacArthur winner, it reflects the way we talk about and the fact that we treat these as literally financial stock, the stock market, rolling stock, stock on the hoof, livestock. They're wild, they're fishes, but yet we treat them and manage them as if they are stock. We make speculations. We want to leave a brood stock that returns interest, a certain amount of interest in how many fish it produces so that you can draw off that, but you have enough to actually grow your stock account. But you miss it because things happen in the wild to maybe your brood stock produces fish, but they don't take. Just like in a business environment, a parent company produces something and for some reason it doesn't sell. And sometimes that has something to do completely outside of their realm, like a war happens and whatever luxury item is not a priority and it affects the stock. So people deal with insecurity, they hate it. I mean, a large part of what the stock market does is try to predict and try to narrow bounds of insecurity. But that's one way that people could relate to things the way they happen in the wild. A lot of business people, even small businesses, they face that insecurity. And yeah, that's the thing that that keeps business from being super efficient. But for other people, it's also opportunity. There's hedge funds mm-hmm. and stuff like that. So there is a way right there to connect our science model with, and not just the science, but what we find about the environment when we do science, and the uncertainty around that, the dynamics around that. We can understand that in the same way that people understand the dynamics of the business world and the stock market and various things like that. So there's a chance to make connections there. But you're right, they don't like it,
mm-hmm.
but in a sense, many of them already understand it in a visceral way, and so we could use that to make a connection.
Well, thank you so much for talking with us today. That was absolutely incredible. Just a really good look into, and just even just the precipice of a look into the way science is done, and your research in particular. And I think this would be something that's going to be amazing for our listeners here, even just to get a little sneak peek into it, to really understand what it is we're doing and the goals of which we're shooting for through these avenues. So thank you so much for joining us.
Oh, you're welcome. My pleasure.